Hey guys, we're going to be implementing another deep neural network for our algorithmic trading. We're going to essentially predict whether or not a market is moving up or down. And based on that market direction, we will place a long or short position. And then we'll compare the returns of that strategy against the benchmark strategy of just buying and holding on to that financial instrument. So it's going to be set up as a classification problem. If the market's moving upward, it'll be one. If it's moving downward, we're predicting zero or negative one, I should say. So it'll make more sense when we jump into it. But for right now, let's just wrangle up some data. We're going to be doing the usual suspects here. I'm going to try it with Bitcoin to US dollar. When I wrote out this package, I just did the euro to US dollar, but hopefully we can do Bitcoin here. Let's actually just take a look to see if I can type here. There we go. Okay, great. So, okay, so we have it from 2014. I want a full year's worth, so let's actually just do euro equals x. What do we got here? Okay, great. So we're getting about 10 years worth of data here. We're doing the euro to US dollar, we're grabbing the adjusted close, and nothing else. We do want to calculate some returns. We do that just by taking the log of the adjusted close divided by the log and the shifted over. We're also going to get the direction. So if the return is greater than zero, we'll classify that as one. Less than zero, we're going to classify that as zero. All right, so we have our directions here, whether it's going up or if it's going down. We also want to include lags, because if you've seen other videos I've made on forecasting, you use the past 5 days or the lag terms to predict the next value. And so we'll go ahead and create 5 additional columns, and you'll see we get something that looks like this. So we have our dates, adjusted close, return direction, lags 1 through 5. So now we're going to implement our deep neural network. We're going to use TensorFlow and Keras, and we're going to be importing the sequential model, and we're going to optimize with Atom. So let's get that. There we go. So let's just walk through this a little bit. It's, I suppose, 3 layers. We have 2 reload layers and then a sigmoid layer. We're just going to do 64, and we're going to use accuracy for our metrics. I'm not going to jump into this too deep because this might turn into a long video, but just know that this is our neural network here, and we've just set our model as the sequential model, and we're creating our dense layers here. Good way to split up your time series data is using the NumPy split function. Just pass through your data and call the number. So we're going to do a 70-30 split. When I was writing this out, I did an 80-20 split. I just want to see if we split the data differently, if it makes any effect on the outcome. Now, we need to normalize the features, so let's grab the average and the standard deviation, and we can normalize it using the Gaussian. I'm not exactly sure how you pronounce that, but we're just going to create 2 additional variables where we take our train and test set, and we normalize the features. We're going to then, look, you can go ahead and see that I've ran that already before, but we will fit the model on the columns in our train set here. We're gonna just do 50 epochs. We're not gonna shuffle it because that wouldn't really make any sense, right? We wanna make sure that the data is in sequential order. So great. Now that we have that, let's throw it all into our data frame there. And let's get the accuracy and the validation accuracy. Okay, this is pretty interesting. So what are we looking at here? Basically, the blue line is the accuracy on our okay, so when we broke up our train test data sets, right? We are basically also doing a validation accuracy and an accuracy on that. So you can think of the accuracy that it's trained on, and then the validation accuracy is sort of like the out of sample accuracy based on just that original test set. This is sort of a weird graph. I didn't expect it to even be this close. I expected the validation test set to be farther down. And then I'm not even sure what this flat line is. It could be because of the split. It could also be for any other reason. We're doing US dollar to euro. When I wrote this last time, it was euro to US dollar. But let's just roll with it, see what happens. So now let's evaluate the model. You can see we have an accuracy of 0.51 or 0.52. So now let's create a prediction, and we're essentially saying, okay, if the prediction is where it's greater than 0.5, let's say that's an upward direction, otherwise it's a zero. And what that looks like, it's just an array of ones and zeros. But this is where we'll flatten it so there's no floats, and we get something that looks like that. And then we're going to transform the predictions into a long short position. So we're creating a column of, or we're creating a variable using the predictions that we used on our fitted model on the normalized training data set. Right? And we're saying if the accuracy is greater than the accuracy on what we just did here, where we evaluated the columns and the direction, then we're going to assign that as a 1. If it's lower than our accuracy prediction, we're going to assign it a 0. Right? So this is just saying, you know, if our confidence in our prediction is greater than our test or our training, let's be confident and say that our prediction is that it's moving in the direction that we've predicted it to, right? So then we're going to transform the predictions that we've made here into a column in our training set as prediction, where if the prediction is greater than 0, we're saying it's 1, a long position, or a -1, short position. So then we're going to calculate the strategy, the returns given the positions, just by multiplying the prediction with the return, and that'll represent our strategy in the data frame. And let's go ahead and get the sum of it. So you can see here that our strategy outperformed just the benchmark prediction in our in-sample test set. So let's plot it just to see what it looks like. And excellent. You can see the blue line is our just benchmark returns of US dollar to euro. And if we had implemented our deep neural network to predict the price movements, is the orange line. You can see that we have a pretty good spread, right? We're outperforming the return benchmark. So this is just the in-sample training set. Now let's do it on our validation, and it's essentially the same process. So let me just roll on through that. And And you can see that we've done significantly worse than our benchmark. And when we graph it, it looks like this. So we've split it up a little bit differently. You can kind of see that it's just following along, but then pretty early, you know, in before July and June or so, it looks like things, you know, just started to get away from it, especially July of 2021. Just couldn't really keep up with the predictions, were underperforming the strategy, underperforming the return. That's why it's important to evaluate your model on an out-of-sample test set to actually validate whether or not your fitted model is working. One thing that we can do to improve the performance of our model is to include some additional features that might help it along. So let's add those features. We're going to add momentum, volatility, and distance to our data frame. And then we're basically going to go through the same process. And now let's take a look at our new data frame. So we have what we had before, adjusted close, return direction, legs 1 through 5, but now we have the momentum, we have the volatility, and we have the distance. And it might be worth sharing how you calculate that. So momentum is just the rolling average of the previous return, right? And then volatility is the return, the rolling of a certain number. In this case, we're using 20, the standard deviation of that shift. And then the distance we're just defining as the adjusted close minus the momentum, essentially. But the momentum is 50 instead of 5. All right. Ba-ba-ba. And we're moving the shift on the outside of that calculation. So that's also important for calculating distance. Okay, great. Let's refit and train test. So we're doing, again, a 70-30 split on the test set, and then we're going to normalize it using the same methods that we did above. And we're going to update our dense layers to 32 instead of 64 to represent our additional features, but just about everything else is the same. We're going to refit it. And let's evaluate. You can see that it's performing a little bit better than our last one. And we'll do the same thing. We'll create a predictions variable and then transform that into a long short position. Calculate the strategy returns. And here we go. The strategy has outperformed the benchmark. So that's really exciting to see. And it looks like it's done pretty well for itself. And let's plot it. Bam! Look at that spread there. That's looking pretty juicy if you are interested in maybe implementing this. But again, this is on the in-sample training set, right? So for our in-sample training set, it looks like the model performs very well. It's able to outperform the returns, but that's largely because the data has seen it already or had all that data inside of it. But the true test of whether or not our model, especially a deep neural network model, is performing well is by putting it to the test and seeing what the results are for an out-of-sample data set. So let's go ahead and do that now. Again, we're just going to go through the model like before. Please ignore some things that we've seen here. And so, okay, so one thing I forgot to mention in the last one, it is kind of nice just to see what the value counts of our positions are. So our model is putting out way more long positions than short positions. So that might be an indicator of whether or not things are going well or things are going bad. And you can see, again, on the out of sample, we are getting a strategy that is underperforming our benchmark returns. But we can go ahead and plot that anyway and view the cumulative returns of this. And you can see the strategy, again, once again, sort of understands it in the beginning. And then simply around July, again, it just starts to get away. And the benchmark returns of the instrument outperform the strategy and the predictions that are being made by the deep neural network. So I want to be clear, in case you're not as familiar with how classification works, the neural network that we're implementing here is essentially, it's not an artificial intelligence. It's not some kind of, in other videos I've made a reinforcement learning type agent. This is simply a deep neural network that we're trying to train to predict the market movements of the US dollar to euro index. So in this case, in the data that I've compiled or in some way of the way that I've gone through it, it wouldn't be, I definitely wouldn't put this in production at all. It's clearly in our back testing, it's underperforming the benchmark returns. But this is a solid way of getting started and tinkering about. Maybe you want to include a different instrument. Maybe you want to include a different, a time frequency. I think in our data, it was day to day. You could do intraday and see if that works any better. But this is a simple classification. Is it going up or is it not going up, basically? And whether or not we can build a model to predict that. I hope you guys found that enjoyable and insightful. I know we weren't getting the kind of strategic returns that we were getting or that we were hoping for, but again, this is a good cautionary tale to make sure that whatever strategy you're implementing and testing and backtesting, that you also have an out-of-sample set that you can test that strategy against to make sure that you're actually robustly testing your strategy or not. Because depending on how you're plotting your data and your performance, you might think that you have a really great strategy when you don't. That's all for now. I'll see you in the next video. Bye. Hey everyone, thanks for watching. If you've made it this far, please consider subscribing or watching another video. I really appreciate it. Bye.